السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى أيضا: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector, and curer. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. Alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless this gathering of ours, and may He make it a gathering where the malaika shroud us with their wings, the angels shroud us with their wings, the sakina, tranquility descends upon us, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala envelop us with His rahmah, and may He the Almighty make high mention of us in the seven heavens. Inshallah ta'ala, the topic for today's talk will be the tafsir of the greatest verse in the noble Quran. Before I delve into the subject matter or into the topic itself, I wish to touch on something that is extremely important, and that is in regard to knowledge in general. When you look at knowledge, there are various sciences of knowledge, various faculties of knowledge, but however vast, however different the streams and the sciences of knowledge may be, they may go to the east or the west of this world in terms of advancement, technology, etc. However many types of knowledge there may be, I'm not trying to put down any type of knowledge, but all I wish to do is highlight that the most noblest of all knowledges, the most noblest of all streams of knowledge, the best of knowledge is the knowledge in regard to the tafsir of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The best of knowledge, the pinnacle in knowledge is the tafsir, the sciences of tafsir, the knowledge of tafsir in regard to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because after all, it is a knowledge, it is a stream of knowledge that is connected to the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the science of tafsir is a dazzling sun. It is a bright full moon. Because in general, the nobility of a stream of knowledge, the beauty of a stream of knowledge is in relation to the content of that stream of knowledge. And what is the content of the stream of tafsir? It is none other than the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, kalamullahi azza wa jal, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most great, the mighty. The speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a spring. It is a spring out of which comes out different types of wisdom, different types of virtue. It is a deep, vast ocean. Each time a diver dives in, he can come out with a pearl. It is such a beautiful and vast ocean. And in regard to the virtue of the Quran, in regard to the virtue of the Quran, in other words, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, above all other speech is like the virtue or the grandeur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over all of His creation. And this Quran, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it has come to us from the King of all kings, the Jabbar, the Compeller, the Creator of the heavens and the earth. And the Quran is a matter of great importance. So it is upon us to open up our hearts, to open up our hearts, to ponder, to reflect, and to also understand that it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Azza wa Jal, the King of all kings, who is talking to us. Because these are things that we need to indoctrinate in our hearts before starting off this beautiful journey, before embarking on this beautiful journey in the tafsir of the Quran, of the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And especially whenever we come across great ayat, ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. Because all of us have brought in iman. We have brought in iman. We believe in the six articles of faith. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses us, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, it is upon us to sit up and listen attentively, because it is Allah the Almighty addressing us and talking to us. Likewise, when we enter the science of tafsir, it is upon us to open up our hearts, so that our hearts will absorb the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending to us in that particular ayah or in that particular passage that we are going to discuss insha'Allah ta'ala. So nevertheless, we will be spending this morning, this beautiful morning, with a verse so great, Allahu Akbar, a verse so great that it is known as the greatest verse of the Noble Quran. A verse so great, as we go inshallah ta'ala, we will talk in regard to the virtues of this great verse. It is known as the greatest verse of the Noble Quran. So for the sake of barakah and reflection, we will start off today's talk inshallah ta'ala with the recitation of that particular verse.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم.
My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this ayah, this verse, which is known as Ayatul Kursi, Ayatul Kursi, I won't translate that because we will be touching on the word kursi as we move with the tafsir of the ayah. So I will translate it at that time. For now, let's go ahead calling it Ayatul Kursi. Ayatul Kursi is the greatest ayah of all of the Quranic verses. It is the greatest ayah. So in terms of the translation, the direct translation of the ayah, Allahu la ilaha illa hu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no deity worthy of worship other than Him. Al-Hayy, the ever-living, the eternal. Al-Qayyum, the sustainer of all of His creation, of all that exists. The one who maintains all of His creation. La ta'khuduhu sinatun wala nawm. Neither does sleep or even a tiny slumber ever overtake Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Lahu ma fi samawati wa ma fi al-ard. To Him Azza wa Jal belongs whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. Who is it that can intercede with him except by his permission? مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَشْفَعُ عِنْدَهُ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. He knows what is presently before them and what will be after them. And they encompass not a thing of his knowledge except for what he wills. وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. His kursi extends over the heavens and the earth. وَلَا يَؤُودُهُ حِفْظُهُمَا. And their preservation tires him not. وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْعَظِيمُ. And he is the most high, the most great. Allahu Akbar. Before we go further, it is upon us to reflect on the ayat of the Quran, on the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not upon us just to pay lip service to the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but rather we should deeply ponder on the verses of the noble Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he states, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. That do they not ponder on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the Quran? أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Or have they got locks on their hearts? Making tadabbur, pondering on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is closely connected to an individual's heart. Because if we were not to ponder on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our hearts become dark. Our hearts are sealed up. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala questions that if they cannot ponder on the Quran, that means that there are locks upon their hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us all to ponder on His great words. In another place, Allah the Almighty states, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. Allahu Akbar. A book, أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ. We have sent it down to you, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What type of a book? مُبَارَكْ.
كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكْ.
A blessed book, Allahu Akbar. A book full of blessings.
لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ.
So that they may ponder on its verses.
وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ.
And so that the ones of intellect, the people of intellect, may be reminded. It will serve as a reminder for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to ponder on His on the great verses of the noble Quran. Now we move on to a hadith which has been recorded in Muslim. Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, he states that once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he addressed him, Ya Abul Munzir. Now Abul Munzir was the kunya of Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu. So he addresses him, Ya Abul Munzir. Atadri ayyu ayatin min kitabillahi ma'aka a'zam. Do you know which of the verses from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the greatest in your opinion? Which verse do you consider the greatest from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? To which Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, he replies, Allahu wa rasuluhu a'lam. Allahu Akbar. He replies that Allah and His Messenger know best. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to say, Ya Abul Munzir, once again, O Abul Munzir, Atadri ayyu ayatin min kitabillahi ma'aka a'zam. According to your opinion, what do you think is the greatest ayah from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now, Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, he realized that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was expecting a reply from him. So he went on to reply to the question of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by stating,
Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum.
He recites the ayah. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fadaraba fi sadri. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pats him on his shoulder, pats him on his chest. In another narration it has been mentioned that until he goes on to say, Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu goes on to say that until he felt the coldness of the hand of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his chest, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam patted him and then said, Wallahi, لِيَهْنِكَ الْعِلْمُ أَبَا الْمُنذِرِ. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, يا أبا المنذر, O Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiallahu an, rejoice by your knowledge, O Abu Mundhir. May this knowledge be a source of respect, honor and benefit to you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prays for Abu Mundhir. And then he goes on to say, by the one in whose hand is my soul, this ayatul kursi, it has a tongue. Allahu Akbar. This verse has a tongue. It has two lips and it glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the foot of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say in that very hadith, by the one in whose hand is my soul, it has a tongue, the ayatul kursi, it has a tongue, it has two lips and it glorifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the foot of the throne. Now a few things to be noted from this beautiful hadith is that, number one, Ubay radiallahu an, he was a hafidhul Quran. He was a hafidhul Quran. And he was also known as the Sayyidul Qurra. In other words, the leader of the Qurra, the reciters of the noble Quran. So he, number one, being a hafiz, hafidhul Quran, and also being a beautiful reciter of the Quran, he chose this ayah from over a 6,000 ayat, because he had memorized the whole Quran, and the whole Quran amounts to almost over 6,000 ayat. So a few things to be noted from this hadith, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, is that the minute Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, when he first asked him out of respect for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that Allah wa Rasuluhu a'lam, that Allah and his messenger know best. And then when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him a second time, he, without even hesitating, at the spur of the moment, he chose this ayah from over 6,000 ayat. He did not take time to think. He did not ask for time to think. He did not give this answer after perhaps a long week of thought. Nay, but rather, the minute Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him the question, he answers Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because the second time Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, the Sahabi radiallahu anhu, he understood that permission has been granted by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to answer the question. And also Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was expecting him to make ijtihad, to try and find out the best answer. Nevertheless, the crux of the matter is that the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'een, in general, they understood the importance of Tawheed. Allahu Akbar. They understood the importance of Tawheed. They understood the importance of Ikhlas. They understood the importance of Taqwa. They understood that Tawheed was the most important factor in the Noble Quran. And that is why we see Ubay radiallahu anhu, he did not waste any time thinking about whether it could be from the ayatul ahkam, whether it could be from the verses that are pertinent in regard to the laws and rulings of the sharia. No, he did not think whether it would be an ayah from the ayat of the qasasul umam al-madiyah or the qasasul anbiya. He did not think whether it would be an ayah from the stories of the prophets or from the stories of the nations that preceded us. Or he did not even waste time thinking whether it could be an ayah from the ayat pertaining to the wasf of Jannah, the description of Jannah. Nor did he think that it could be an ayah which describes the ahwal of Yawm al-Qiyamah, the horrors of the day of Qiyamah. Nor did he think that it would be an ayah from the ayatul adab, where it teaches us etiquettes and how we need to do things in our religion. He did not waste time. Rather, he understood that if it has to be the greatest verse in the Noble Quran, it has to be in relation to Tawheed. It has to be in relation to the ikhlas of Allah, in regard to ikhlas, in regard to sincerity. And that is why, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, he chose this great ayah, Ayatul Kursi, and he was right in his choice. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam congratulated him in regard to that. Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he is reported to have stated in some of his compilations that in regard to Ayatul Kursi, it is an ayah which entails all of the proofs and evidences in regard to Tawheed, Allahu Akbar. There are so many signs and evidences in regard to Tawheed. All of that has been gathered in Ayatul Kursi. It is such a great ayah, Allahu Akbar. And that is why Ubay radiallahu anhu rushed to that ayah, in other words, rushed to choosing that ayah, because for a fact, he knew that this had to be the ayah that is the greatest ayah in the Noble Quran. Hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. And this hadith, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, highlights the love for Tawheed that the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in had. Aisha radiallahu anha, she narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he once sent an individual on an expedition. Ba'atha rajulan ala sariyatin. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent a person on an expedition. And this individual, when they went on that expedition, he used to conduct salah, he used to conduct the prayers for the sahaba, and for every salah, towards the end, the salah that he used to recite aloud, he used to cap off the recitation by reciting Suratul Ikhlas. He used to recite, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. He used to recite this surah. So once the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in returned back to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the act of this Sahabi. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then informed them, سَلُوهُ لِأَيِّ شَيْءٍ يَسْنَعُ ذَلِكَ. Please ask him why he did that. So the Sahaba who went with him, they asked him in regard to that. In other words, why do you often recite Surah Al-Ikhlas in every prayer of yours? He goes on to clarify, لِأَنَّهَا صِفَةُ الرَّحْمَانِ وَأَنَا أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَقْرَأَ بِهَا. Allahu Akbar. He goes on to clarify that it is the quality, or that surah describes the quality of Ar-Rahman, the most merciful. وَأَنَا أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَقْرَأَ بِهَا. And that is why I love to recite that surah. Allahu Akbar. فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then went on to say, أَخْبِرُوهُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّهُ. Then inform him that Allah the Almighty loves him. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill our hearts with pure love for him, Azza wa Jal, and his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, it is upon us to recite Ayatul Kursi at various occasions in accordance to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is in accordance to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to recite Ayatul Kursi after every salah of ours, after every single salah. Hadith is in Sunan al-Kubra of Imam al-Nasai rahimahullah. And Abi Umama, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أبو أمامة الباهلي رضي الله عنه, he states that رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم is reported to have said, من قرأ آية الكرسي في دبر كل صلاة مكتوبة. As for the individual who recites آية الكرسي after every salah, Allahu Akbar, after every fard salah, لم يمنعه من دخول الجنة إلا أن يموت. There is nothing to prevent him from entering Jannah then and there other than death. Allahu Akbar. Death will be the only thing that will keep him away from Jannah. In other words, if he were to die, he would enter Jannah immediately. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open the doors of goodness for us, and may he grant us entry into Jannah. Look at the beautiful hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me repeat the hadith again. Man qara'a ayat al-kursi fi dubri kulli salatin maktuba. The individual who recites ayatul kursi after every fard salah, lam yamna'hu min dukhulil jannati illa an yamut. Nothing prevents him from entering Jannah other than mouth, other than death. That, in other words, death will be the only thing that will keep him from Jannah. So if he were to die, he would fly into Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he mentions in his famous book, Zadul Ma'ad, he says, سمعت وبلغني عن شيخنا أبي العباس ابن تيمية رحمه الله. He says that I have heard about my Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, that he is reported to have said, ما تركتها عكيب كل صلاة. الله أكبر. He is reported to have said that I have never ever left reciting Ayatul Kursi after every salah. Right after your salah, after your fard salah, you're supposed to recite Ayatul Kursi, as this is in accordance with the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, we were discussing about the occasions where we are supposed to recite Ayatul Kursi. Number one being after every salah. The next occasion is every single night before we sleep. And hadith is in Bukhari. This hadith is in Bukhari. It is a famous hadith. It is about the story of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu and his captive. Allahu Akbar. Interesting and an amazing hadith. The narration goes along the lines of these words. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Ramadan, they had collected zakah and sadaqah, etc. They had collected it and kept it in one particular location. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appoints Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu to look after that collected zakah. The zakah that was collected in Ramadan, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appointed Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu to look after that zakah. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, the first night, now he was put on watch, so he was looking after the zakah. He slightly fell asleep. He went into a small or a tiny slumber. The minute he got up, he saw an individual pilfering away at the goods of zakah. He rushed to that individual and he caught him. And he said, I've caught you red-handed. Let me take you to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To which that man, who Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu caught, he started to say, oh please, please have mercy on me, have pity on me, let me go. I'm a very poor person, I'm in dire need and dire poverty, and that's what brought me to come and do this, please let me go. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, feeling pity for him and feeling sad for that particular individual, he let him go, he released him. The next day morning, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks him, Ya Abu Huraira, what did your prisoner do last night? Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed about it. He was informed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about it. So he asks Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, even before Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu could inform Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about it, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him about his prisoner. To which Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he said, Ya Rasulullah, he started to complain. That person, I caught him, but he started to complain of being in great need of poverty and having children to look after. So I took pity on him and I let him go. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said, but he was lying. He was lying. He is a liar and he will be back again. Allahu Akbar. Now Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu was shocked. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is warning him that he will be back. So Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu decided, I have to be on a very attentive guard to catch him the second time. So the second night, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu was on watch again. This time too, he fell asleep. And the minute he got up, he saw the individual again. The same individual pilfering away at the goods of zakah. He rushes to him and he catches him and he tells him, this time I'm not letting you go, I'm taking you to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now this person again starts to whine and cry away, oh I'm so poor, please have pity on me, I have tiny young children to look after, I'm in dire necessity and dire poverty, that is what has brought me out here to take some things from zakah, please have mercy on me and let me go, don't take me to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To which Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu again felt pity on him, and he let him go. The next day in the morning, again Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu meets Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Ya Abu Huraira, what did your prisoner do last night? Allahu Akbar. To which Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu again informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about his whining and his complaining, and that he let him go due to him taking pity upon him. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then said again, but he was lying and he will be back. Allahu Akbar. He was lying and he will be back. Now the third night approaches and Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu determines that he's not going to fall asleep. He is going to catch this individual. So he did not fall asleep. and this individual comes about again to pilfer from the goods of zakah, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu catches him red-handed, and this time he says, I'm 100% sure, I'm determined, I'm taking you to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I am not letting go of you this time. To which the captive now says, دعني أعلمك كلمات ينفعك الله بها. He says, leave me, let me go, and I will teach you a few words that will benefit you. Allahu Akbar. A few words that will benefit you. In other words, that will bring benefit from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you. Now, this sparked an interest in Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. He wanted to know what these words were. So he asked the individual, okay, ma here, what are those words? To which that individual said, إِذَا أَوَيْتَ إِلَىٰ فِرَاشِكَ, when you go to bed at night, فَقُرَأْ آيَةَ الْكُرْسِي, اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْحَيُّ الْقَيُّومِ, until the end of the ayah, recite the verse, recite ayatul kursi, حَتَّى تَخْتِمْ, until the ayah ends, فَإِنَّكَ لَنْ يَزَالَ عَلَيْكَ مِنَ اللَّهِ حَافِظٌ. Allahu Akbar. For if you were to do that, every single night before you sleep, if you recite Ayatul Kursi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will appoint a hafidh, will appoint a protector over you. An angel will protect you. وَلَا يَقْرَبَنَّكَ شَيْطَانٌ حَتَّى تُصْبِحْ. And not one single devil will get close to you or will approach you until morning comes. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Next day morning, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu informs Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam about what this individual had taught him. And he asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam about it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam clarifies for Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, أَمَا إِنَّهُ قَدْ صَدَقَكَ وَهُوَ كَذُوبُ. Allahu Akbar. He is a habitual liar. He is a habitual liar. But this time he has spoken the truth. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam informed Abu Huraira radiallahu an that he was shaitan. He was the accursed devil. He is a habitual liar. He generally lies, kadhub. He generally lies, but this time he has spoken the truth. In other words, in regard to the virtue of Ayatul Kursi. The next occasion that we are supposed to recite Ayatul Kursi, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is to make it part and parcel of our daily adhkar. To make it part and parcel of our daily adhkar. Morning and evening adhkar. The narration is in Sunan al-Nasai and in the Mu'jam al-Tabarani. It is narrated that Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, he states that his father once told him that he had a vessel, a container in which he used to store dates. He used to check on it and he found out that the number of dates gradually started to decrease. So he, Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he kept guard on that container one night and he saw an amazing sight. He saw a beast. He saw a beast like an animal that looked like a young boy coming and pilfering from that utensil, from that container. So Abdullah radiallahu anhu states, I greeted him with salams. I greeted him with salams and he returned my greeting. And then I asked him, what are you? Are you a jinn or are you a human being? To which he replied, I am a jinn. Then he said to him, Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he said to him, show me your hand. He asked the jinn to show him his hand. To which the jinn showed his hand. And Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he stated that it looked like a dog's paw with dog's fur. The hand of the jinn, it looked like a dog's paw with dog's fur. And then he asked the jinn, do all of the jinn look like this? Do all of the jinn look like this? To which the jinn replied, I know no one from amongst the jinn who is stronger than I. Allahu Akbar. The jinn replies, I know no one from amongst the jinn who is stronger than I. Then Abdullah radiallahu anhu goes on to ask the jinn, okay, so what made you do what you did? In other words, why are you stealing our dates? Then he said, the jinn, we heard that you are a man who loves charity. You are a man who loves charity. Either Abdullah radiallahu anhu, or it was Abdullah radiallahu anhu's father. One of the two. The narration goes along the lines of these words. We heard that you are a man who loves charity, and we wanted to come and eat some of your food. Allahu Akbar. Then Ubay radiallahu anhu, in other words, the father of Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he asks him, what will protect us from you? What will protect us from you? And then the jinn replies, this ayah, and he teaches him this ayah, Ayatul Kursi. If you read it in the morning, you will be safe from us until evening. Allahu Akbar. And if you read it in the evening, you will be safe from us until morning. You will be protected from us until morning. Allahu Akbar. The next day, Ubay radiallahu anhu goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and informs Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about what happened. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then clarified for Ubay radiallahu anhu, the evil one has spoken the truth. Allahu Akbar. The evil one in the sense, the devil, the accursed devil has spoken the truth. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, totaling the occasions when we should recite this grand and powerful verse 5 times a day after every salah. For if we were to do that, only death would keep us away from Jannah. Allahu Akbar. Next is just before sleeping. If you recite it before sleeping, a protector, a hafidh is entrusted over you. A protector is deputed over you, and the devils will not disturb you until morning. Allahu Akbar. The next occasion is to make it part and parcel of our morning and evening adhkar. To make it part and parcel of our morning and evening awrad. If we do recite it morning and evening, we are protected from the devils. If we recite it in the morning until the evening, and if we recite it in the evening, we are protected until the next day morning. Allahu Akbar. But it is upon us not to recite it like how parrots would do, or not to just pay lip service to the Ayatul Kursi just because we have to recite it before we sleep. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum la ta'khudhuhu. We just don't recite it like that. But rather, it is upon us to make tadabbur on its meanings. And that's why I touched on tadabbur in the beginning. We are supposed to ponder and reflect on the meaning of this great verse. Likewise, we need to concentrate. We need to concentrate strongly whilst we recite it. We need to intend tajdeedul iman. We need to intend reviving our iman. We need to intend rejuvenating our iman. We need to intend spiritual rejuvenation. And also we need to intend the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if a believer does that, if a believer makes tadabbur, if he concentrates, if he intends the reviving of his iman, if he makes remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, indeed he will be spiritually protected as well as spiritually rejuvenated, refreshed, and his iman will be grounded firmly upon tawheed. Allahu Akbar. And he will free himself from all types of shirk, from shirk akbar and shirk asghar. And he will also free himself and protect himself from the influence of the accursed devil. Allahu Akbar. Now, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us begin our journey, our beautiful journey, with this great, grand and powerful ayah. Allahu Akbar. There's just one thing that I wish to clarify before we go further. And that is, when I was prepping for the talk, whilst I was preparing my notes for the talk, I realized that if I were to try and cover the whole tafsir of Ayatul Kursi, the minimum I would need is 2 weeks. 2 weeks to cover the whole of Ayatul Kursi. At least 15 days. Because there is so much of content to touch on. That is just the minimum. But for today's talk, inshallah ta'ala, I have concised things, I have summarized things, and I will try my level best to give you the gist of it, to try and give you the tafsir or the important points in a nutshell. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us. So now let us begin our beautiful journey with this great, grand and powerful ayah. The ayah starts off with the greatest and the grandest of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is Lafdul Jalala, that is Allah, Allahu Akbar. It starts off, Allahu la ilaha illahu. So the first word from the Ayatul Kursi is Allah. This is the greatest word ever. This is the greatest name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why scholars say in regard to it, Lafdul Jalala, it is known as the word of Jalala. The word of might, the word of power, Allahu Akbar. That name is Allah. Allah ismul li sahibihi kullu jalal. Allah is a name for the one who has perfect or all might. Allah ismul li sahibihi kullu kamal. Allah is the name for the one who has complete and utmost perfection. Allah ismul li sahibihi kullu sultanin wa jalal. Allah is the one who owns everything, to whom all power, all dominion and all might belongs to. Allah huwa al-ismu alladhi ma dhukira fil qalili illa kathara. Allah is the name that is mentioned when a person is in difficulty, when a person is in poverty, when a person is in misfortune. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about plenty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about wealth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfills his need. Allah huwa al-ismu alladhi ma dhukira 'inda khawfin illa ammana. Allah is the name that when it is mentioned, when it is remembered in fear, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about peace. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about security. Allah huwa al-ismu alladhi ma dhukira 'inda karbin illa kashafa. Allah is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it is mentioned during misfortune, during calamity, during trials and afflictions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an out for that individual. Allah solves those problems and calamities for that individual. Allah huwa al-ismu alladhi ma dhukira 'inda hammin illa farraja. Allah huwa al-ismu alladhi ma dhukira da'ifun illa qawwah. Allah huwa الاسم الذي ما ذكر فقير إلا أغناه. الله هو الاسم الذي ما ذكر ذليل إلا أعزه وأواه. الله هو الاسم الذي تستجاب به الدعوات. الله هو الاسم الذي تستمطر به الرحمات. الله هو الاسم الذي من أجله قامت السماوات والأرض. الله أكبر الله أكبر. الله, it is because of Allah that the heavens and the earth remain. It is because of Allah that if an individual remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during sadness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about happiness. And if an individual remembers the name of Allah when he is weak, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes him strong. If an individual remembers the name of Allah when he is poor, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about wealth and plenty for him. And if an individual remembers the name of Allah when he is humiliated, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about honor, might and dignity for him. When an individual remembers the name of Allah and prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah answers his invocations and his dua. And it is because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that blessings rain down upon us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open the doors of goodness for us. A'ilahum ma'allah, a'ilahum ma'allah. Can there be any other deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can there be any other God worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah the Most High, Allah the Most Greatest, Allah the Most Merciful, Allah the Most Beneficent, Allah the King of all Kings, Jalla Jalalu, Azza wa Jal, Allahu Akbar. So this great ayah, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, begins with that great name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is Allah, which is known as Lafdul Jalala. Next in line, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is the eternal testimony of Tawheed. It is the grace, it is the greatest declaration of faith. It is the greatest declaration of faith and the greatest testimony of Tawheed. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, "Wa khayru ma qult ana wa nabiyyuna min qabli," that the best statement that I and the prophets alayhi salatu wa sallam before me have uttered is La ilaha illallah. لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. This is the best statement that I and the prophets before me have uttered. Allahu Akbar. The best statement that I and the prophets before me have uttered is لا إله إلا الله. There is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah. وحده, He is to be worshipped alone. La sharika lah. There is no partner unto him. Lahul mulk. To him belongs the kingdom and the dominion. Wa lahul hamd. And for him is all praise. Wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. And he is all powerful over every single thing. It is the greatest statement uttered by the anbiya alayhi musallatu wasalam, uttered by the prophets alayhi musallatu wasalam. It is the first of statements ever conveyed to any nation. The first thing that the prophets alayhi musallatu wasalam would convey to their nations would be qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu. Say la ilaha illallah. Profess la ilaha illallah and you will be victorious in this world as well as the hereafter. And it is the first statement that the first of mankind and the last of mankind will be questioned about on the day of judgment. And there will be no other answer to that question other than la ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. There is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the statement of tawheed. It is the statement of ikhlas. It is the statement of taqwa. Sufyan ibn Uyayna, rahimahullah, he states that there is no greater blessing upon us than the blessing where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us La ilaha illallah. And for proof, he brings about the ayah which is in Surah An-Nahl.
أَتَى أَمْرُ اللَّهِ فَلَا تَسْتَعْجِلُونَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ يُنَزِّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةَ بِالرُّوحِ مِنْ أَمْرِهِ عَلَى مَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ أن أنذروا أنه لا إله إلا أنا فاتقون.
أتى أمر الله فلا تستعجلوا. The command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is coming, so be not impatient for it. سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. Exalted is He and high above what they associate with him. يُنَزِّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةَ بِالرُّوحِ مِنْ أَمْرِ. He sends down the angels with the inspiration of his command. عَلَى مَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِ. Upon whom he wills of his servants. أَنْ أَنْذِرُوا أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاتَّقُونَ. Informing them, warn that there is no deity except me. There is no God other than me, so fear me. فَاتَّقُونَ, so fear me, Allahu Akbar. And be conscious of me, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. This profession of, this uttering of tawheed, La ilaha illallah. What it means is, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, La ma'buda bihaqin siwa. La ma'buda bihaqin fil wujudi. Illa Allah, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah means that there is no God, there is no deity in reality worthy of worship. Bihaqqin, there is no God truly or in reality worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty starts off Ayatul Kursi by touching on ibadah to highlight ubudiyyah for us, to highlight the sole purpose behind our creation. As He, our powerful maker, states in the noble Quran,
وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ.
That I have not created jinkind or mankind for any other purpose other than the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have been created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So la ilaha illallah, in it there are two parts. One is negation and the other is confirmation. La ilaha, where we say there is no God, we negate. And then we say, illallah, we confirm, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no deity except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a statement that first negates and then confirms. And that is a well-known style of emphasis. For example, if I were to say, I ate veggies this suhoor in the morning, I had veggies. If I were to just say I had veggies, you all may think, or you all may be under the impression, okay, perhaps he must have eaten veggies, he must have eaten chicken, he must have eaten rice and bread. But on the other hand, if I say, I did not eat bread, I ate veggies. Now, I'm completely negating the possibility that I may have eaten bread and I only ate veggies. So if you negate and then confirm, it brings about an emphasis, a beautiful emphasis. And that is the same in regard to La ilaha illallah. For if we were to say, I worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not emphasized. But when we say, there is no God, there is no deity worthy of worship, we negate and then we say, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we negate and then we confirm, it is a beautiful style of emphasis. The scholars, rahimahullah, they mention, the one who negates but does not confirm has not brought in tawheed and he has not brought in iman. The one who says there is no God and he does not confirm afterwards, naturally there is not a drop of iman in his heart and he hasn't brought in tawheed because he's only negating. Likewise, the one who confirms but does not negate, he also has not brought in tawheed. For if a person were to say, Allah, there is no, if a person were to say, Allah is the God, or if he says Allah is God but he does not negate, then there is a possibility that there may be something in his mind that states there may be other gods with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah forbid, that he may associate partners unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in this statement of tawheed, when we say La ilaha illallah, when we say La ilaha, we free our hearts from every single thing other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We free our hearts from all partners, that we say that there are no partners, there's nothing, nothing at all. There's nothing at all to be worshipped, illallah, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is to be worshipped all alone, associating no partners unto him. So by negating and confirming, we bring about pure tawheed and pure iman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open the doors of goodness for us. So by saying La ilaha illallah, we establish tawheed, we establish ikhlas, and we free ourselves from all types of shirk. So like I said earlier, shirk is of two types. Shirk akbar and shirk asghar. Where shirk akbar is to worship something with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To associate partners unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or to worship something else in the place of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is known as shirk akbar, major shirk. So we free ourselves by uttering this kalima, this statement of tawheed. We free ourselves from shirk akbar, and likewise we free ourselves from shirk asghar, which is to perhaps do things for something or someone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say for example, the evil quality of riya, where you do things for name and fame, where you do things for to show off to people. Perhaps you give out charity to be known as a philanthropist. You perhaps go to the masjid and pray so that you are known as a pious person, as a righteous person. You're not doing it for the sake of Allah, you're doing it for the name and the fame. You're doing it so that people will talk good about you, so that you will be known as a pious and righteous person, so that you will be known as a philanthropist. So all of this comes under shirk asghar, which is known as minor shirk. But by uttering the statement of tawheed, La ilaha illallah, with firm and deep conviction, and with tadabbur and with concentration, reflecting on its meanings, we free ourselves from shirk completely, major and minor shirk, reviving our iman and likewise rejuvenating ourselves spiritually. Now after stating, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after he stated that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is a powerful statement. He said, Allah, La ilaha illa hu. There is no deity worthy of worship other than him. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about signs and evidences to establish that statement of tawheed. This is the speciality of Ayatul Kursi. And this is why, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Ubay ibn Ka'ab radiallahu an chose this ayah to be the greatest of ayat from the Noble Quran, and he was applauded by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam for that beautiful choice. And this is why my beloved Shaykh, Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he stated at the beginning, the quote I mentioned in the beginning, that all of Tawheed is entailed in the ayah, Ayatul Kursi, because the Ayatul Kursi is full of signs and evidences to establish pure Tawheed. Allahu Akbar. Now there are about 10 to 11 signs to point out pure Tawheed. We will try to swiftly cover all of them, inshallah ta'ala. So they are known as Burhan or Barahin. Barahin in the sense, signs and evidences to prove the uluhiyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also to prove pure tawheed, to prove monotheism, to prove ikhlas. So sign number one, Burhan number one, is the very next word after La ilaha illahu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about a word, Al-Hayy, Allahu Akbar. Al-Hayy is one of the great names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ever-living, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is eternal. Now what we need to understand is we need to make tadabbur, we need to ponder, we need to reflect. We don't just skim by translating it that Allah is ever-living and Allah is eternal. Just sit and think. Just ponder for a moment. What a great creator we are subject to. A creator, a maker who is eternal, who has no end and who has no beginning whatsoever. Allahu Akbar. There was no beginning to that eternity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah huwa al-awwal, huwa al-akhir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was the first and He was the last. There is no beginning for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nor does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have an end. Nor was there a non-existence before that eternity. Now each and every one of us, before we were born perhaps, we were non-existing. We were not existing. There was a non-existence. There was a void. We were missing. We were missing until we were born. When we were born, then we came into existence. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in regard to Allah the Almighty, there is nothing known as a non-existence before that eternity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala highlights to us when He mentions Al-Hayy, that Allah the Almighty is the ever-living, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the eternal. He is Al-Awwal, He is the first and He is the beginning. There was nothing before Him and His eternity will never, ever, ever perish. Every other thing other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will perish, will inevitably perish. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, كُلُّ شَيْءٍ هَالِكٌ إِلَّا وَجْهًا, that every single thing will be destroyed. Every single thing will perish except for the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Except for His face, every other thing will perish. Every other thing will be destroyed. Allahu Akbar. In another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, and this has been decreed by our powerful maker, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ, that every soul shall taste death. Even Malakul Maut will taste death. Every single creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will perish except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For He is Al-Hayy. He is the ever-living and He is the eternal. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about His name Al-Hayy after stating La ilaha illa hu. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ever-living, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's life is free from a beginning and an end, unlike the lives of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The life of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from defects, is free from flaws, is free from sicknesses, is free from fatigue, is free from sleep, etc., which are all qualities, which are all part and parcel of the lives of others other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we can't even strike this, there's no point in even mentioning it. But for our weak minds, just think, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, how on earth can we even try to compare these man-made idols, stick and stones, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How on earth can we even try to attribute uluhiyah? How on earth can we attribute that these sticks and stones can be worthy, can be things worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah the Almighty is the most greatest, the most high, with all of these great and grand qualities that is necessary and absolute for the ruler of all rulers and the king of all kings. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings about Al-Hayy after La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illahu. It is a sign to prove pure tawheed. Now we move on to Burhan number 2, sign number 2. Al-Qayyum, it's the next word afterwards.
Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum.
Allahu Akbar. Allah la ilaha illa hu al-hayy al-qayyum. Al-Qayyum is also another great name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that points out towards the qayyumiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It points out the qayyumiyyah of Allah jalla jalaluh azza wa jal. Now, what is qayyumiyyah? Qayyumiyyah is of two types. Number one is that it means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is completely independent. Allah the Almighty is not dependent on anyone or anything. Allah is in no need at all towards anyone or anything from His creation. Allah is completely independent. Allahu Akbar. He is not in need towards His creation. But rather, on the other hand, we, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are such weaklings that we are in dire need towards our powerful Maker, towards our powerful Creator. He, the Almighty, states in the Noble Quran, in Surah Fatir,
يا أيها الناس أنتم الفقراء إلى الله والله هو الغني الحميد.
O mankind, أنتم الفقراء. O mankind, you are those in need. Allahu Akbar. أنتم الفقراء إلى الله. You are those in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ هُوَ الْغَنِيُّ الْحَمِيدُ. Whilst Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free of need, He is completely free of any type of need, and He is the praiseworthy. Allahu Akbar. So that is part one of qayyumiyyah. That is one meaning. And the second meaning is that He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He alone is the sustainer, the nourisher, the protector, the curer, and the one who maintains all of His creation. Allahu Akbar. He is Al-Qayyum. He is the one who maintains all of His creation. He is the one who sustains all of His creation. He is the one who protects all of His creation. Whilst we, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are in utmost need towards our powerful Maker. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in Surah Ar-Rum,
وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَن تَقُومَ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضُ بِأَمْرِهِ.
And it is of the signs, it is of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is of His signs, is that the heavens and the earth are maintained by His command. Allahu Akbar. It is by the divine command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the heavens and the earth are maintained. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So this is what is meant by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bringing the word Al-Qayyum. In other words, Qayyumiyyah. There are two meanings, and both of those two meanings have been covered. And I hope it has struck a chord in our hearts to reflect on the greatness of our powerful Creator. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is so powerful, He is so great indeed. And this is how we need to ponder and reflect on the verses of the Quran when we recite it, and especially in regard to Ayatul Kursi. Now we move on to Burhan number 3, sign and evidence number 3.
La ta'khudhuhu sinatun wala nawm.
Allahu Akbar.
لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He states after that,
الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم.
Allah is the ever-living, the eternal, upon whom slumber nor sleep ever overtakes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at how powerful our Creator is, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. Hadith is in Muslim. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, he narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said,
إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنَامْ وَلَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَن يَنَامْ يَخْفِضُ الْقِسْطَ يرفع إليه عمل الليل قبل عمل النهار ويرفع إليه عمل النهار قبل عمل الليل حجابهن لو كشفه لأحرقت سبحات وجهه ما انتهى إليه بصره من خلقه.
أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم is reported to have said that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not sleep. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنَامْ وَلَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ أَنْ يَنَامْ. Nor does it befit His Majesty and His glory that He should sleep. يَخْفِضُ الْقِسْطَ وَيَرْفَعُ. He raises the scales of things and lowers them. يُرْفَعُ إِلَيْهِ عَمَلُ اللَّيْلِ قَبْلَ عَمَلِ النَّهَارِ. The deeds of the night go up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the deeds of the day. And the deeds of the day go up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the deeds of the night. حِجَابُهُ النُّورِ. Allahu Akbar. The veil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is made of light. The veil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is made of light. لَوْ كَشَفَهُ. If Allah the Almighty were to remove His veil, لَأَحْرَقَتْ سُبْحَاتُ وَجِهِهِ مَنْ تَهَى إِلَيْهِ بَصَرُهُ مِنْ خَلْقِهِ. Allahu Akbar. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to remove His veil, the light of the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would burn every single creation in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And scholars go on to say, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to remove His veil, the light of the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would burn every single thing into ashes, because nothing is hidden from the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would burn to ashes, because nothing is hidden from the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the qa'ida, the principle amongst the scholars, is that whatever is negated in regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it establishes the opposite in regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we negate sleep from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that means attentiveness. In other words, the opposite of sleep is established to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In general, sleep is something attributed to the creation. As we are weak, and sleep is a result of fatigue, and it can never ever be attributed to our powerful and almighty maker. Weakness, fatigue, tiredness, sleep, all of these things can, sickness can never ever be attributed to Allah, the King of all kings. My beloved Shaykh, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says beautiful words. He says that the pleasures and the enjoyments of this dunya is a result of hardship and fatigue. The enjoyments, the pleasures of this dunya is a result of hardship, tiredness and fatigue. If you take sleep, if you're really tired, if you're like knocked out, you would enjoy a good night's sleep. You would enjoy a good sleep. So it is only after you are really tired that you will enjoy sleep. If you are really tired, if you are really hungry, only then will you enjoy food. If you're really thirsty, if your throats are parched and you're really thirsty, only then will you enjoy a cool, quenching cup of water or a cool, quenching drink. On the other hand, if a person is well refreshed and had a good sleep, he cannot enjoy sleep. If a person has eaten to his fill, his hunger is satiated, he will not be able to enjoy food. On the other hand, if he has drunk water to his fill, he will not be able to enjoy a cool drink or a cool cup of water. So all of these things are attributed to tiredness, fatigue. So how can the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to which tiredness, fatigue and other weak qualities have been attributed to, how can that creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or how can something which that creation made out of its own hands be worshipped in the place of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why do we fail to recognize the power and the might of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now we move on to burhan number 2, sign number 4. Because as we are running out of time, we'll try to move swiftly. The fourth sign or evidence in regard to the pure tawheed of the Ayatul Kursi is the next verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the next few words where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allahu Akbar. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. La ta'khuduhu sinatun wa la nawm. لَهُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. The supreme dominion belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever is in the heavens and whatever is in the earth belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single atom, every single molecule in this universe belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is the king of all kings, to whom complete power and dominion belongs to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in the Noble Quran, in Surah Ala Imran,
قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وتعز من تشاء وتذل من تشاء بيدك الخير إنك على كل شيء قدير.
قل اللهم مالك الملك. Say, O Allah, owner of all kingdom, you give sovereignty, you give power, you give kingdom to whom you will, and you take sovereignty, you take dominion away from whom you will. You honor whom you will, and you humble whom you will. In your hand is all good. Indeed, you are powerful over all things. Allahu Akbar. As for what man owns, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it is either one of the two situations. It will either, whatever man owns, it will either perish and leave him. However much wealth we own, it depletes, it decreases. It never keeps on increasing. Our wealth keeps on depleting, keeps on decreasing. It will perish and leave us. So it's either one of the two situations in regard to what we own, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. It will either perish and leave us, or we will perish and leave it. Someone else will inherit it. Allahu Akbar. This is how temporary this world is. Harun al-Rashid, rahimahullah, a great king, when he was on his deathbed, he cries out to his courtiers, he cries out to his subjects, I wish to see my grave where I will be buried in. I wish to see it. He was on his deathbed. He was very sick. The courtiers, the ministers, they advised against him going to the graveyard to see his grave, because it would make things worse. But he wanted to go see his grave. And as it was his final wish, they abided and they took him to his grave, a grave that had been freshly dug for the king. The minute he saw that dark hole in the ground, he looked back towards his great palace. He looked back towards his horses. He looked back towards his wealth. And then he started weeping. He started crying. And then he recites the ayat.
مَا أَغْنَى عَنِّي مَالِيًا.
Allahu Akbar. My wealth has not availed me.
مَا أَغْنَى عَنِّي مَالِيًا. هَلَكَ عَنِّي سُلْطَانِيًا.
My wealth has not availed me, and my kingdom, my power, my authority has perished away from me. Allahu Akbar. When you go to the grave, what is the point of you being a king or a pauper? What is the difference if you lived in a palace, in a mansion, or in a tiny hut? Because at the end of the day, you are not going to get a VIP qabr. You are not going to get a VIP grave. You are going to end up in the same hole that every single man, every single individual goes to. Allahu Akbar. You may be decked with designer brands. You may have Louis Vuitton bags. You may have different brands. You may be wearing Mont Blanc and all of these fancy brands. But on that day, you will be wrapped up in a blank white piece of cloth, and at times that white shroud may be bought by someone else's money, unless and of course you have already bought your shroud and kept it ready for yourself. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. What is the point of wearing all fancy stuff when at the end of the day we are going to go to that qabr, leaving all of that behind? He cries out, Harun al-Rashid, the king with so much of wealth, palaces, wealth, money, horses, everything. He cries out, my wealth has not availed me, and my kingdom, my authority, my power has perished away from me. And then he looks up to the heavens, he raises his hands, and he cries out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
Ya man la yazulu mulkuh, irham man qad zahala mulkuh. Ya man la yazulu mulkuh, irham man qad zahala mulkuh. يا من لا يزول ملكه ارحم من قد زهل ملكه.
Oh, the one whose kingdom never ever perishes. Oh, the one whose dominion never ever perishes. Oh, the one whose authority never ever ceases. Have mercy upon the one whose kingdom has perished. Allahu Akbar. This is the difference, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. This is the difference between the king of all kings and a mere worldly king. Allahu Akbar. Whatever we own will perish, and inevitably we are also going to perish. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we belong, and to him we shall return. Minha khalaqnakum wa fiha nu'idukum wa minha nukhrijukum taratan ukhra. It is from earth, it is from sand, it is from clay that we created you all. Minha khalaqnakum wa fiha nu'idukum, and to that clay, to that earth, you will be returned back. Allahu Akbar. Wa minha nukhrijukum, and it is from that very same earth and that same clay Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring us out again. Allahu Akbar. So this is in regard to the kingdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Moving on to the fifth sign in regard to the pure tawheed and the grandeur of Ayatul Kursi, that is the next few words. Man dhalladhi yashfa'u 'indahu illa bi'idhni. Allahu Akbar. Who can intercede by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except by his permission or by his will? These few words, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, establish complete authority is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that none has the right to intercede except after the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In regard to the maqam al-mahmuda, hadith is in Bukhari. I'll run through it very swiftly. Hadith is in Bukhari. On the day of Qiyamah, the narration goes along the lines of these words. On the day of Qiyamah, nations, all of us, we will be running helter-skelter on the day of Qiyamah. We will not know what to do. We'll be in so much of fear and fright. We'll run from place to place. Eventually, we'll run up to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam and cry out to Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Oh Adam, Ya Adam, Abul Bashar, you are the father of mankind. Please intercede on behalf of us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Adam alayhi salatu wasalam will say, Inna Rabbi qad ghadiba al-yawma ghadaban lam yaghdab qablahu mithlah wa lan yaghdab ba'dahu mithlah. Indeed, my Lord is angered today. He is angered, such an anger that I have never seen such anger, nor will we ever see such anger. He is so angry today. Nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. Adam alayhi salatu wasalam will cry out, Nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. He will only be worried about himself. He will say, I disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when Allah commanded me not to, when Allah forbade me from eating the fruit of that tree. I disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I fear meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Go to Nuh and ask him to do it for you. Then we will all run to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, and we will say the same thing to Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. And Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam will also say, Nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. Go to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. We will go to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. He will also say, Nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. Go to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Then we will run to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, who will also say, Nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. Go to Isa. And then we will go to Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam, who will also say, Nafsi, nafsi, nafsi. Go to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then we will all run to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We will say, Ya Rasulullah, intercede on behalf of us, Ya Rasulullah. We are in extreme fright, Ya Rasulullah. to which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one we are ashamed to follow, the one we suffer complexes to look like, Allahu Akbar, the one we feel ashamed to, the one we feel ashamed to adopt his lifestyle, Allahu Akbar, he will get up and say, yes, I am the one for that. And he will go by the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will fall down in sajda, in prostration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with beautiful words. And in that narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states that words will come to me, words of praise that have never ever come to me will come at that time. And I will begin to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I will start praising and praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until Allah the Almighty will say, irfa' ra'sak washfa' tushaffa' wasal tu'tah. Allahu Akbar. Irfa' ra'sak washfa' tushaffa' wasal tu'tah. Allahu Akbar. O Muhammad, raise your head, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Raise your head and intercede, your intercession will be accepted. Ask and your request will be granted, Allahu Akbar. Look at the honor given to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And we are the ummah of our beloved Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. To which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam will lift up his head and he will say, Ya Rabbi ummati, ummati, ummati. Ya Rabbi ummati, ummati, ummati. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will once again only cry out, ummati, ummati, ummati. Oh my nation, ya Allah. Oh my nation, ya Allah. Oh my nation, ya Allah. But sadly, that very nation has forgotten Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That very nation does not want to adopt the lifestyle of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That very nation wants to adopt the lifestyle of the enemies of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah the Almighty forgive our sins and may He accept our good deeds. Swiftly moving on to the sixth sign, Burhan number six. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. This sign establishes the perfect knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The perfect knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything. وَسِعَ كُلَّ شَيْنَ عِلْمًا. The knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything. Nothing is hidden from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty knows every single thing. Even if a leaf were to fall in one corner of the earth, Allah the Almighty knows about it. The seventh sign, Burhan number seven. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ إِلَّا بِمَا شَاءٍ. That mankind, the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not, their knowledge does not encompass anything from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except that which Allah the Almighty wills. This points out the weakness of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However intelligent an individual may be, however intelligent a person may be, there is indeed a deficiency in his or her knowledge. There will be some void or some blank thing that he or she does not know. For example, if you take the matter of the ruh, if you take the matter of the soul, technology has advanced so much, but still no one has come to a proper conclusion or in regard to knowledge about the ruh, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. That the ruh is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The soul is the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in regard to all of that, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. You have not been given from knowledge except a very, very little. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. This is in regard to the comparison of our knowledge with the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a vast, vast ocean, whilst our knowledge is not even equivalent to a tiny drop which may drop off from the beak of a bird. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open the knowledge, doors of beneficial knowledge for all of us. We move on to the final sign, and with that I will wrap up because we are running out of time. And that is in regard to the ayah, in regard to the words in the Ayatul Kursi, which I said I will be touching in the beginning because it is of vital importance. And that is where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, وَسِعَ كُرْسِيُّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And why I wanted to touch on this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is because Ayatul Kursi is at times generally translated as the verse of the throne. It is translated as the verse of the throne. But you see, the throne is the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not known as ayatul arsh. Nay, it is known as ayatul kursi. The arsh is something different and the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something different. The arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the footstool of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ayatul kursi in reality is the verse of the footstool. Allahu Akbar. Hadith is in Ibn Hibban. And it is a hadith which is classed sahih by the scholars of a hadith. Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, he narrates that once I entered the masjid, dakhaltul masjid, fa'idha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam jalisun wahda. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was seated in the masjid all by himself. And I go up to him and I say, Ya Rasulullah, fa'ayyuma anzalallahu alayka a'adham. Can you tell me, Ya Rasulullah, what is the greatest thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed upon you? To which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, Ayatul Kursi. It is Ayatul Kursi, the greatest verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed upon me. And then the Sahabi, Abu Dharr radiallahu anhu, goes on to say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on to further clarify, Ya Aba Dharr, O Abu Dharr, مَا السَّمَاوَاتُ السَّبْعَ مَعَ الْكُرْسِيِّ إِلَّا كَحَلْقَةٍ مُلْقَاتٍ بِأَرْضِ فَلَاهُ. Allahu Akbar. The seven heavens, and in another narration, the seven heavens and the seven earths, in comparison to the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is like a tiny iron ring flung in a vast desert. Allahu Akbar. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, ponder, reflect on the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seven heavens and the seven earths. We haven't even covered planet Earth. Talk about this universe and all of the universes. All of the universes together, put together. All of the heavens, the seven heavens and every single thing in all of those heavens combined together in comparison to the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like a tiny iron ring which has been thrown in a vast desert. The tiny iron ring is the seven heavens and the seven earths, and the vast desert is the kursi of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith does not end there. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say, wa fadlul. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say, wa fadlul arshi ala al kursiyyi. كَفَضْلِ الْفَلَاتِ عَلَى الْحَلْقَةِ. Allahu Akbar. And then the comparison of the kursi with the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is once again like a tiny iron ring flung in a vast desert. Now the kursi of Allah has become the tiny iron ring, and the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that vast desert. This is how powerful a creator, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that we are subject to. A creator who is so powerful, who has created such great creations, such as the arsh, which is the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the kursi, the footstool of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Almighty states in the Noble Quran, Ar-Rahmanu 'ala al-'arshi istawa, that Allah the Most Merciful, He ascended over His throne, kama yaliqu bi sha'nihi wa jalalihi, in a manner that befits His majesty and His glory. Allah the Almighty, the owner of the throne and the owner of the kursi. Ayatul Kursi is translated as the verse of the footstool of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Having said that, we wrap up today's talk, even though time did not permit me to touch on the remaining few signs that point out to the grandeur of this great verse, Ayatul Kursi, and the greatness of this great verse, which points out to pure tawheed, pure ikhlas, pure taqwa, and the grandeur and the greatness of our powerful maker. Nevertheless, try your level best to ponder and reflect on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how we need to ponder and reflect on the ayat. When we recite the ayah now, at least now that we have done somewhat of the tafsir of Ayatul Kursi, it is upon us when we recite the Ayatul Kursi to ponder and reflect on the meanings, to concentrate on the meanings, so that the greatness and the grandeur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fills our hearts, resulting in our hearts being split open and taqwa being taqwa enlightening our hearts, and our hearts becoming soft and supple, absorbing that which is good. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins, and may He the Almighty soften our hearts and not let our hearts go hard. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enlighten our hearts, and may He the Almighty help us to make the best out of this month of Ramadan, as if it is our last month of Ramadan. And may He accept our good deeds, may He accept our fast, may He accept our Taraweeh, our Qiyamul Layl, and all other deeds. And may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah, just as how He united us here this morning with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وآخر دعواي أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. Whatever correct said was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if there was anything wrong in what I said, it is from me and shaitan. And I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the accursed day.